Members of the board, the first business is the election of officers to the board. Mr. Reeves has asked to allow like statement.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Hall. Merry Christmas to everyone, by the way. One of the things I'd like to say is at this time, I ask the board to join me in re-electing the chair, vice chair, to their current positions and to continue our meeting times as they're currently arranged. And I so move.
There's a motion on the floor that the chairman and vice chairman be elected to the same positions for the coming years. Any discussion on the motion? Did anyone want to make any nomination other than that?
I'll keep on now, sir.
All those in favor of the motion, please signify your vote by raising your right hand. It's unanimous. That takes care of two of the items in the organization. Congratulations, Mr. Hayes and Mr. Odom. We now need to adopt a resolution fixing the time and place for your regular meetings in the coming year.
That was a part of the original motion, but I'll state it again to continue the time that we currently have them arranged.
What days do you wish to have them meet?
They're still Mondays, first,
first and third Monday in each month.
One at three, same. One at six.
One at three and one at six?
Yes.
And meet here at the government center?
Correct.
And that is your motion?
It is.
Is any other motions with respect to the meetings? The motion is you continue the pattern we followed in recent years, meeting on the first and third Mondays of each month. And we'll meet beginning at 3 o'clock on the first Monday and 6 o'clock on the third Monday. And that the meetings be held in the government center. Are you ready to vote? All those in favor of adopting the motion setting up your meetings in time and place, raise your right hand. Unanimous. The final part of the organization is the annual examination of the official bonds. They have been listed in your agenda. Previous boards have set for the finance director a $100,000 bond, for the registry of deeds a $50,000 bond, the tax administrator a $100,000 bond. Anybody having more than $100 is covered under our general liability policy. The limits on that and the coverage we carry is set out in your agenda. Any question as to what the bonds are? Does anyone have any suggestion or preference that they be changed?
Only if you deem it appropriate to change. If you don't, I would move that they continue as they are.
These have been the recent settings of them, and that serve have not been used at all. Motion is that the bonds be approved as set out in your agenda. Discussion of that. All those in favor of approving those bonds, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. I believe, Mr. Chairman, that takes care of the reorganization.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hoyle. The invocation I'll lead tonight, and then the Pledge of Allegiance, if you will stand with me, we'll have a moment of silence and then some words. Even though our minds may not always meet in perfect harmony, and that is okay and as it should be, let our hearts remain united with the best intentions, always, for the goodwill, peace, and prosperity of the citizens of Lee County. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It's great to have you here tonight. The first item on the agenda was to be a joint public hearing with the Lee County Planning Board relative to Mr. Wilson's rezoning petition. As I'm sure you may have seen on the door, that has been pulled, and we will not get into that tonight. And so therefore, if there's anyone here who did not see that and wished to participate in that, I'm sorry, but we will not be having that part on the program tonight, and you may be excused at this time if you wish. At this time, we will have the presentation of the Employee of the Month, and I'd like to call on Mr. Clark to present our special designee.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, T.C. Yarbrough has been selected as Employee of the Month for December 2009. T.C. has been employed with the Lee County Sheriff's Department for 5 years and serves as a sergeant in the Civil Division. T.C.'s primary responsibility is to serve papers on absent parents. He goes above and beyond to get someone served, as he does not take no for an answer and is always trying to get that extra bit of information. T.C. realizes that his extra work to serve papers on absent parents will result in meeting financial security for children. He also maintains the web page for deadbeat parents on the Lee County Sheriff's Department website. T.C. has excellent communication skills. He is an honest and hardworking employee that treats everyone with great respect in all dealings. His demeanor in the courtroom should be an example to all, as he actively prohibits any disrespect of the court, judge, and others. T.C. is very dedicated to his family and active in his church and in the community. He and his wife, Kimberly, who is here, have 6 children and 7 grandchildren. Based on his dedication, service, and commitment to Lee County, the committee respectfully asks that you join us in awarding Sergeant T.C. Yarbrough Employee of the Month for 2009.
Now, Mr. Yarbrough, would you care to say anything?
No, sir.
Okay. Well, if you'll come forward, please, have a few things for you. This is your day in the eyes of the commissioners and Lee County, and so congratulations, and I have a couple of things I want to give to you as a reward for your good work. One day off with pay. One large two-topping pizza. That'll be good. One free movie rental. Two free two-liter drinks from Papa John's. A special Star Award, which is yours to keep, and as our note of appreciation to you for all you've done for this county. Hope you'll continue to. And then finally, Employee of the Month, which reads, T.C. Yarbrough for going above and beyond regular duties to be an outstanding employee of Lee County. And so once again, we thank you.
Congratulations, T.C.
We will look now at the agenda. Are there any additions that any of the commissioners have to make to the agenda before we approve it? I would also like to mention that in the approval of the agenda, we will have the clerk make note of the fact that the motion has been removed concerning Mr. Wilson's petition. So having said that, do I hear a motion to approve the addition or the agenda as provided? Okay, moved. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Approved unanimously. Thank you very much. Next is the approval of the consent agenda. You have that before you, and I would entertain a motion for approval of the consent agenda.
So moved.
It's been moved to approve the consent agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? There is no opposition, so thank you very much. That has been approved unanimously. Yes, ma'am.
I just add a comment. Sometimes when these items are in the consent agenda, there's recognition that people watching may not know. And I just want to say a special thank you. There was an item on here for bids for canopy at the Enrichment Center. And I noticed that those donations came from the Saturday Night Dance Group to fund this. And so I appreciated that they didn't request taxpayer funds for this, but they took it upon themselves to raise that money, and I just want to say thank you.
I'd like to second that, and that's a very nice gesture, and it makes a good point. I think there are items on the consent agenda that we have the opportunity to read and understand, and sometimes they are not picked up by the public, and I think that's entirely appropriate, certainly after the fact, to just mention that and to praise those people who have done good things like that, and that is a wonderful thing that has been had occurred. Next we'll have our public comments. I have several names down here, and I'd like to just say this first. We have from Brookhaven, we have Mrs. Audrey Smith, and she will come up a little bit later. She's scheduled in the regular program for a presentation, and so as I go down the list, we'll move on to the second. And there is Mr. Harry Griffin, and he's from Henley Road, and he, I believe, was here wishing to speak on behalf of the rezoning, and that would not be necessary. I don't know if he's here at the moment. I don't think he is, and so we'll move ahead to the next two speakers remaining. And I would remind the speakers that this is time for a three-minute presentation to the board, and Mr. Hoyle will keep time. And so I believe the first presentation is Mr. Clark. And your name and address, please.
My name is Keith Clark. My address is 212 Acorn Drive in Raleigh. I am moving around the table to my representation. I wanted to first acknowledge you, wish you a Merry Christmas. 78% of the people in America prefer that as they're rooting in Christmas time. I wanted to also thank you for the work that I know will be culminated tonight and moving forward with what's necessary to complete our high school. Much of what I have done has has been motivated by the desire to see that accomplished. There may be some who are not yet ready to accept the will of the people, but if you're reading my blog every day like you're supposed to, you'll see that the arguments were put forward that might be made against it and the possible answers that might be used to counter them. But I had the opportunity, we'll have the opportunity to address you, and I simply wanted to make sure that we understood one thing before I began that 10 minutes later on. A red box is located over at Walmart, and you can put your credit card in it, and for a dollar you can get a CD out of it and take it home and watch it and take it back the next day and you're done. And so it will save me some time trying to get to the real point, because my 14-year-old daughter looked at what you're going to see and she said, "Dad, A, I don't think you know what you're talking about. And B, I don't think I understand why you're telling them this." And so with that kind of challenge, I'm going to work hard to do that in 10 minutes. And thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. The next speaker is Mr. Akinosho. And if you would come and take the mic and introduce yourself.
Good evening, everybody. Merry Christmas to all of you. My name is Mark Akinosho, Reverend Mark Akinosho. I live at 820 Hayden Avenue here in Sanford. I saw something on the agenda that I wanted to see the outcome on the item 8, number E, the relief of tax for Windstream. And I don't know the decision yet, so I wanted to see where you guys go on that before I make my comment. Please.
Well, I think this is a time to make your comments, and of course you can listen and observe when we get into the discussion of that. I think that you could return, if you wish to, at our next meeting and add comments. I'm not sure that there's an arrangement to accommodate you later in the program.
Okay. Maybe I just make a small comment. Okay. I'm a small businessman here in town. My primary job in this community that brought me to Sanford, I'm a pastor of a small church, and I have a laundromat and dry cleaning here in Sanford. And I have also been very involved in this community by the grace of God. I came to this meeting tonight because of what I saw with Windstream and the tax relief. I applied last year for the same relief as a small businessman. And we are all talking about stimulus for small men, small little men. And I was denied the same thing that Windstream is applying for today. And as a small businessman, I don't have a deep pocket. What happened to my business when we're listing, tax listing? I listed everything, but the problem was with another company I was leasing an equipment with. And it was an oversight. I wrote a letter, I wrote an appeal to this board. And some laws were coded that I am not qualified. I have faithfully paid my taxes to Lee County in thousands of dollars every year without, I did not even go until 31st of the month of the December. I pay my tax on time, and I'm a good citizen here, and to deny me the same opportunity to have a tax relief at this time and to give it to a big corporation, I think it will be a slap on every little man that lives in Lee County, like me, who is trying to create a job. I've hired people in this community, and then to deny me the same opportunity that will be given to Windstream, I think that's not where our country wants to go. That's not a bailout for the big business. We need to be equal, justice for all, not just for small, not just for the big business. That's what I want to appeal to the commissioner tonight. If you give it to Windstream, I am well qualified. I wrote a year ago, and the same thing was denied to me. And I don't know where you guys are going tonight, but if you vote for it, I'm not saying don't give it to them, but you have to do it in retrospect, to look back and give me the same grant. That's my appeal tonight. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Moving now to old business, page 82 to 84 in our notebooks. This has to do with relief of discovery penalty for Martin Marietta Materials, and if Mr. Brinson will come forward and speak to us about this, and then we'll get into appropriate discussion.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board. A couple meetings ago, I presented to you a discovery situation where Martin Marietta Materials had a discovery of the property when their business was audited by a contract company. The amount of discovery is a little over $10,000, of which about, I think, $9,500 is actually county dollars. The equipment or property that was discovered was underground tunnels and underground equipment that was related to the business process. We have settled on the value. Martin Marietta agreed that it should be personal property, and we have picked it up as such. It was not taxed as real estate, it was not taxed as personal property, therefore creating a discovery situation. I'll be happy to answer any questions I can for the board.
Okay, well, I'd like to ask for a motion, and then we will get into a discussion of this as seems to be appropriate. Is there a motion of some sort?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we reduce that penalty to $2,500.
All right. The motion is made that the penalty be reduced to $2,500 from the $10,418.75, which is in our material for consideration. Is there a discussion about this, please, before we vote?
I'd like to ask the tax administrator, have you changed your position, your recommendation?
No, sir, I haven't. I would recommend to deny it, just because I don't want to determine what this board thinks is a appropriate situation for not filing or not listing property. So I'm going to stay with the denial.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I have real serious concerns. I appreciate Mr. Akinosho coming and sharing his thoughts today, and that sort of goes along with what I've been struggling with this. We've got to be consistent. And I see granting abatement as just in extremely severe cases, and I don't see this as one. You know, it's on the books, it's law. If you have oversights or a problem and, you know, for whatever reason they don't catch it, I mean, there's penalties involved, and all businesses face that. We've got to be consistent and be fair.
So they actually have staff to oversee this kind of activity,
yep.
And if they fail to do their job, then they ought to seek relief from the people who failed to do their job. We would do the same thing if he failed to do his job.
Yes, ma'am.
And so I'll call the question and get it over.
All right, the question's been called. Does that complete comments? Because we're preparing to vote now.
If there's some more information that somebody wants to share with me, I'm happy to listen.
Well, I want to say this. Mr. Acrisino came before the board with his problem. At that time, I spoke to him and tried to get him some help, which I wasn't successful. But I looked at what Martin Marietta has done in the county. Martin Marietta, since 2005, has donated over $41,000 to the county in materials. Greenwood School, indoor furnace. They've been a very good corporate neighbor, and from what I found out, this was just an honest mistake. And I have a problem with penalizing people for honest mistakes. They pay their taxes. And that's about all I got to say about it.
Well, I'm going to call for a vote now. Unless there's something else that's burning that someone needs to say about this.
Well, I certainly don't disagree with you about honest mistakes that they happen. And I would say that Mr. Okinosha's mistake was honest mistake.
It was honest mistake, sure.
And so, you know, the price for paying for honesty ought to be the same across the board. And that's all we're saying here. But in addition to that, if we're going to go into the bartering business, then I don't know about the donations. This is actually the first I've heard, other than when you said it at the last meeting. And I still haven't seen anything that supports that position on it. But if we're going to start accepting donations in exchange for oversights, honest or otherwise, then we are no longer the Board of Commissioners, but the Board of Barterers.
That's right.
And that's what it reduces it to. I don't disagree that there are extenuating circumstances, but I don't see them in this case.
Okay. Thank you very much for your comments. We will now vote. All in favor of reducing the penalty as moved by Mr. Pascal to $2,500, please indicate so by saying aye.
Aye.
Would you show hands, please? Okay, and all in opposition, show your hand, please. Okay, so the motion fails by a vote of 4-3. Therefore, I believe it's appropriate that you proceed to provide or manage this penalty as you have proposed. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now we'll move to new business. This is a request to appear before the board, Mrs. Audrey Smith, on behalf of Brookhaven Community Development and Action Committee. Mrs. Smith, are you here? And welcome. Come forward. How are you?
I'm nervous. I've never done this before. This is new territory for me. First, I'd like to thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Hayes, and County Commissioner, to set aside time on your busy agenda for us at Brookhaven. I have some handouts here for you. We had addressed with Mr. Pascal a request to appear here today to discuss some concerns and issues that Brookhaven has. Brookhaven wants to thank you again for setting aside the time to discuss our concerns and update issues that the concerned residents of Lee County and Brookhaven Development have. First included with your package of information you have in front of you is the letter sent to Mr. Lyons and Mr. Alexander regarding their respective property located in the Brookhaven Development. The letter sent to Mr. Lyons will have to be reset as the address the property tax office had was incorrect. So I am going to remail that letter back out to him at the address given by the post office. Mr. Lyons' property is located at 3417 North Ridge Drive. It is in total disrepair, and because of this disrepair, the home has become a home or a shelter for feral cats and used as a dumping ground. This summer we've had the opportunity to have animal control out to Brookhaven numerous times regarding feral cats. At one given time it was said that we had anywhere from 25 to 30 feral cats residing in this building. The animal control did come out. I want to thank them for doing that. They brought traps. I hope that they have relocated the cats or taken appropriate measures to handle the situation. If you notice the picture, the very first picture behind the letter there, that's the house that Mr. Lyons owns. It has broken windows, broken doors, rotting floors, and the lot is unkept and as is the drive. It has also been used to dump garbage there. You can see in the pictures. mattresses and other items and paraphernalia that have been dumped there. It was my understanding that when I purchased my home in Brookhaven, that the gentleman that redid my house and sold it to me had offered to buy that house. But at the time, Mr. Lyons suggested that he could only take $40,000 for this house and nothing less. He has not done anything to manage the property. He has not done anything to repair it. He has not made any efforts to Brookhaven community in any way to clean up the area. The property owned by Mr. Alexander, if you look at the second picture, is in desperate need of being cleaned and mowed. The property has been used as a dumping ground as well. We believe this lot should be maintained by the property owner and cleared of all debris. We also recognize that there are there is a website for county ordinances. I went out there, and honestly, as a layperson, I found it a little difficult to read. So I'd like, if you would please, point me in the right direction of any ordinances that might cover these kinds of situations in the future. We at Brookhaven are also concerned about street lighting issues. We do have a few street lights on Brookhaven and Northridge, but we still have many areas that are dark and without adequate lighting. We are requesting additional street lights to be put in Brookhaven to help divert such concerns as burglaries, arson on said properties. We also have requested additional police presence and have been working with Sheriff Carter and Lieutenant Privette in getting a renewal and stronger community commitment for a safer community. We would like to take this time to thank both Sheriff Carter and Lieutenant Privette for all that they have done for Brookhaven. We also have some sewer concerns. Some of the property owners we have septic tanks out there. And some of those septic tanks have not been repaired, and they have not been repaired with upkeep because of financial matters. A lot of the folks living in Brookhaven, like myself, are on limited incomes. They do work, but there are a lot of us out there that are either on medical disability or retirement. And we find it quite expensive to be able to maintain our properties. And that's a major health concern. And we would have requested from the city of Sanford information regarding on how we might have a sewer line ran into Brookhaven community and have the homeowners tap into that. And they were very gracious and very prompt in replying. They did send us this information packet and a form of a petition that we can sign, and did state that 51% of the homeowners has to participate. And they gave us an estimate of how much it would cost for each homeowner to tap into it. If the homeowners choose to tap into it at the time the project is done, it would be around 50% of the actual cost. If not, it would be 100% thereafter. And the estimates they gave was between $4,000 and $8,000, which is a huge chunk of money. And I'm, quite honestly, I don't have that. I understand that there is a possibility of a loan from the city of Sanford, whereas we might be able to get a loan at an 8% rate and pay over a period of time, probably through our water bill. Even with that, that's still putting a heavy burden on Brookhaven residents to come up with the balance. And I'm not sure how that loan would work. If I choose to sell my home in a year or whatever, does that loan go with me, or does it stay with the new owner of the house? And that's something that's a major concern. Some of the information in here was referring to annexation to the city of Sanford. I don't know where that stands. I understand at one point in time that was a consideration. So we need further information on that. I'd like to thank Mr. Darrell Ballard, the engineering technician for the city of Sanford, for his prompt reply and his generous information. We would look as citizens and residents of Lee County, hopefully for a grant that might help our homeowners be able to better afford tapping into that sewer line. I think having a sewer installed would be both beneficial to the county and would be absolutely beneficial to the residents of Brookhaven. One of the other things that we have noticed is utility lines. We have utility lines that in numerous occasions have been struck by lightning or has been tree limbs during storms has blown into it, which has knocked out our power and knocked out our utilities. I would like to thank the county and the county utilities because they did come out this past year and trim the leaves away. So I want to mention that and I want to thank you for that. But my suggestion is that maybe the utility lines could be buried at some point so we don't have that problem. The state, I understand that Northridge Drive and Brookhaven Drive is a state-owned highway, and I believe the state, I'm not certain about this, but somebody, either the state or county, members of the Department of Transportation came out and did mowing along the wooded areas there, and I want to tell you how much that is greatly appreciated. I came home one day and I found this huge truck in my lawn cutting my trees, and that was kind of a shock, but that's also part of being a homeowner, I guess. In addition, there is a pond located near the homes of Brookhaven that needs to be drained and cleaned out. In the past, animals have drowned there and have gone there and died, and that, again, is a health concern to our residents. I was informed by the landowner that the pond will be drained and cleaned up. As of today, this has not occurred, and we'd like to see that happen because that could be a hazard to children, not just to pets or animals, but to our children. And we would like to request that Lee County arrange 2 times a year when large household debris can be picked up by the county for recycling. We would maintain, the county could identify specific areas where they would be willing to pick up debris from, and residents would then be responsible for getting the debris to that point so that could be picked up and recycled. And that's really about all that I have at this point. Do you have any questions for me or for the community of Brookhaven?
Well, thank you very much. That's what I was going to open the floor up for the commissioners to discuss and ask you any questions that we wish to do. So are there questions among us?
Are you sure this is your first time?
I know. She wasn't nervous at all.
I have never, ever done this before, and thank you.
You've done an excellent job.
Thank you.
I would start by saying that we could certainly have community development to take a look at meeting with them and sort of prioritizing some of the things that I've heard you discuss. It is no easy task to tackle all these things at one time.
No, it's not, and we understand that, and I think we at Brookhaven, speaking for my friends and my neighbors, I think we can be a little bit patient on that.
Well, patience is a part of it, but what I'm speaking of is prioritizing and organizing based on resources available right away.
Right.
One of the things we're talking about.
I think the major concern probably is the health issues with the sewage and with the pond and with the house where the feral cats chose to choose as their home. I might mention, too, we did see I saw a coyote this summer, too, so I don't know whether he was residing there or not.
John, what do we have in the way of county ordinances? Is there anything that would make this be a public nuisance, or?
Well, the solid waste ordinance covers the illegal dumping in the neighborhood, and we can have Joe Cherry look into that and go out there and inspect it, and we can issue citations for that type of stuff. And then just jotting down.
You have to know who was dumping, though, to be able to issue the citation, right?
And personally, I have not seen anyone dumping, but lo and behold, these things do show up. Whether or not they're members of our community, I don't know. I seriously doubt that. Most members of our community are responsible adults. They take care of their property. They try to show pride in their property. And I just can't believe it would be anyone in our community dumping.
Unfortunately, it goes back on the landowner. You know, if you can't identify who's doing the illegal dumping, it will come back on the landowner. The landowner would have to clean it up. You also have issues here with minimum housing standards, which is a community development issue. So when we contact them, that's something they can look at. The health director's in the back. He's taking notes on the issues that involve him. The septic tank issue is an environmental health issue. And if and once again, if there's problems, somebody's going to have an issue where they no longer can get a new septic tank or that property will no longer percolate, then there are grant programs to get sewer extensions to neighborhoods like that. But they're extremely competitive. You end up on a line, you end up on a waiting list to try to get that type of money. But that, once again, that's something that we can go through with community development.
Right. Is there any way the board can maybe jumpstart that for us?
I don't know. That's a good question.
No, the answer is yes.
Yeah.
Super. Are there any other questions?
Who provides the power? Is it Progress?
I have Progress Energy. I'm certain that probably most others do as well.
Okay.
Any of that, any of those issues are those Progress in the in the, who came by and cut those, you know, things back with Progress Energy. So we don't have the equipment to do that type of work. We don't clear right of ways, and we don't clear that kind of stuff back. So.
Has anybody contacted them as far as
They did come out. Someone came out. I'm not sure exactly who it was. I think it was an independent contractor that Progress Energy probably hired. The contractor was actually from Georgia, which disappointed me because we have contractors in this area that could have done the job equally as well, probably faster, and with less expense to the consumer.
You're probably right. But if they're paying the bill, you know how that goes. And I'm not being smart.
I know you're not. Okay. I know.
Well, but here's the other thing. It may be helpful if we make contact with them and get a representative from Project Center to come out and meet with our staff to talk about your concerns. Certainly. I'm hopeful we won't meet again until January. By that time, we should have had enough time for staff to get out and make contact with you all and get some kind of, it's an overwhelming list of things that you're dealing with.
It really, really is. And like I said, we have folks out there that are retired, they're elderly, we have working families with children, they're trying to do the best that they can do for their family and for the community, and we all appreciate that. But by the same token, we have health concerns out there, and they need to be addressed.
We want to tackle those first.
Yes.
And at the same time, you know, it's not like you can only do one thing at a time. We want to look at all that we have going at one time and start making some effort to work on these projects.
I'd like to just ask, Pastor Chalmers, do you have anything else that you'd like to add?
Can I speak right?
Why don't you ask all the residents to stand so we get it?
Would you? Because we all are neighbors and friends, and this is these are my friends. This is my family.
All right.
And I just think that they have done a fabulous job thus far getting me involved in all this. Pastor Chalmers.
protocol has already been established, so it won't take a long time. I want to be, I'd like, I would say, you said to me once, as a preacher, this old lady came to the church. Came to the church, and she had been a devout old Christian lady, and they had a visiting minister with some. She got up to preach, and she said, "Now, Reverend, you take this mint and put it in your mouth, and when it melts, you sit down." I don't have a mint in my mouth. I want to thank all of you for the great contribution that you have made, and the way of making progress, and this lady here, she had been spearheaded to call.
This is my dad.
There.
This is my dad right here.
And my mom back there.
This didn't, all this just didn't happen just all of a sudden.
That's right.
This has been an ongoing thing.
Yeah.
And it's come to the point we cannot tolerate this anymore.
That's right.
There's some hazardous things going on there.
That's right.
Like there's a tree there, and I'm afraid of snakes. There's a tree there almost ready to fall into the highway. And it's confessed it, you see. It's just snake hating. I understand that somebody tried to clean up in there near the road, and they encountered five copperheads in that one little spot. That's a dangerous situation.
Yes, sir.
Kids are playing all around it. Let me say this. I was one of the Marines that started the projects out at Brookhaven with the lightning system. Adcox development. They had to build the development, and there wasn't any lights out there. And they contracted with the Carolina Power Light Company to install street lights. And I had to get the signature from each individual property owner to sign that petition to have street lights put out there. And all that was involved, anyone that was building houses would come out there and build houses. Everybody was subject to the same regulations. So the street lights today. And then now it comes down to city, and we already have city water. And the sewer situation is one of the worst things. We are living on a massive sewer. Mm. My septic tank, I had to have it repaired about five times. Amen? Five times now. Cost me over $100 each time. And it's working properly now, but then all the rest of the houses got septic tanks. And I worked with the county, Lee County, in the beginning of Lyman Bottom, Great Vineyard, Tempton, Lemon Spring Waterline, all that. I got called everything but who I am. I had to go through that. And we even Great Vineyard section. We got all that done by the county commission, and we got a grant for all those projects. Mm-hmm. And the main thing now, if you can help us to do,
right.
is to get a grant.
That's right.
To get a grant. And we arrived at this back then, Mr. Hall was aware of this. Well, I had to go to every household and to knock on the doors and get signatures for that Lemon Spring Waterland, Great Vineyard, every had to get signatures. In order to find out if we qualify, if they qualify for a redevelopment program. And we did. And so when all that happened, Lemon Springs, Waterline was installed, Great Vineyard was renovated, even when I entered Tempton, was thing happened out there in Tempton, all around us were doing them at that time. It was through by grants. And if you can, you will. Help us to get a grant to get city sewer out there. That would be a great help to that community. And to try to dispose, because we get named, we get labeled as to who we are, is where we live. And we deserve a good name, and we are citizens of Lee County. And we do pay tax.
Right.
And we vote for you all. Amen.
That's
Amen.
Right.
That's why you're
that's
there.
Right. That's
44.
Right. Yeah. That's right.
So there's a lot more I can say, but the men have milk.
Are there any more comments or questions from the commissioners?
Ms. Smith, how many homeowners are out there? I'm not really sure. I'd like to say probably 35. About 35. However, some of the residents that live there are renters.
So we have to, I guess, we have to really work with the landowner. I don't know how many of the residences are being rented at this point in time.
So 35 residences, $4,000 a piece sewer, is that?
Mm-hmm. And that's if everybody wants to tap in when the project is ran. If not, then individual homeowners have to pay $8,000.
If we could get a grant for, what is it, $140,000? Development.
That would be greatly appreciated. I mean, I'm on a limited
You still have
income.
To overcome the city's desire mm-hmm. to annex mm-hmm. when they run sewer. And
it's already there.
They're under no obligation to run the sewer out there without the annexation, although I think some of those rules are trying to change, but you know, they're going to control that sewer vibe.
It's our understanding that we're renting the water. What would be the difference between renting the water and Esalie County residents from the city of Sanford versus renting sewer from the city of Sanford?
The county ran those lines and then sold the system to the city. So they're basically running our system on the water, and the county has never been in the sewer business. So it's you know, a little bit different situation here.
I guess it's complicated, and I'm not seeing your end of it. I'm not privy to all the information that mm-hmm. you folks are. Like I said, this is the first time I've ever come across anything like this or even spoke in front of county council. So.
Mm-hmm. That's why we want to try and get the correct staff people to come out.
That's right, and meet with you.
Yeah, evaluating and assessing what needs to be done. Mm-hmm. You're going to learn more, and we'll learn more.
I'm sure.
And we'll get a little closer to getting it resolved.
We would really appreciate it, and we'd like to take this time again to thank you for hearing us. We'd like to wish each and every one of you a Merry Christmas, a prosperous New Year, and thank you.
Let me just say this, and to thank you. I think that this is an important first step. And I think, you know, everybody on the commission, I believe, with no exception, has a real understanding of what you're talking about. And your need is our need. And that's what we're all about.
Amen.
So we'll get started. And I think that it may be, you know, it may take a year or two, but this, you've had taken the time and you've got the courage and you're your family with you here tonight to
have done it without them.
Yeah, right. Well,
they started this.
Yeah, and we wouldn't know
Matthew
this.
Chalmers and Mary started right. this along with right. Mrs. McIntyre and others.
Right.
We love our community, and we love Lee County, and all we want to be is good conservators of our property.
We hear that, and we appreciate it, and we'll try to be good partners in it and do the very best we can. And I think you can tell that from these commissioners from one end to the other. And Mr. Crumpton's a very, very good person on point. He knows how to focus and organize and then bring things to our attention. So we'll get started, and thank you.
Thank you, and have a good evening.
I just want to thank all of you for coming. It won't get done sitting at home wishing
no,
it's
right.
Okay.
No.
I'm sorry it's cold, but you have to come when you can come.
That's right.
Say what you got to say. Mm-hmm. Don't worry about how it comes out. Mm-hmm. We have to get the point. But I do thank all of you for coming. You pay taxes, you own property,
right.
You want the same conveniences that other people.
That's right.
And we don't want a handout, we want to step up.
Well, take the handout too.
We'll take it if it's offered.
Okay. And Merry Christmas to you and your family. Thank you. Okay. Now, you're welcome to stay for more of this kind of discussion on other items, more fun. But you could also leave if you wished. It would be okay. So you're most welcome. But if anybody wants to leave at this time, feel free.
I'm going to take you up on your offer. At least I am.
Okay.
And have a good night, all.
You too.
Thank you.
See you tomorrow.
Okay, moving right along. The next part of our agenda is a request to appear before the board, Mr. Keith Clark.
Mr. Chairman, I really was impressed with that previous presentation. I think it went over a little bit in time. I would be glad to defer to the next meeting if you would like, but I'll be glad to go forward this evening. I don't expect you to spend that time with me.
Come forward. I think we'd like to hear from you. Thank you.
I do want to say, as I'm trying to get here to get started, that I am. We need more communities like that. We need more communities. Talk to you tonight about the subject of the future work needs of the people in our county and about the task, the nature of the task that we face. And I want to talk about Movies to Go versus Redbox. This is video rentals for the month of October. Stores rented, this is in dollars, 45%. Vending, which is Redbox, has already taken 19% of the market. And mail, which is primarily Netflix and to some extent Blockbuster now, 36%. But 19%, when they're charging a dollar, and again, this is based on revenue, you can see what kind of impact they're having in the industry. Here's some of the industry assessment. These machines are to the video industry what the internet was to the music business. Disaster. The next gentleman is the business manager of a union local representing studio plumbers who work in the studios. It's going to kill the industry. Blockbuster is scrambling to introduce its own rental kiosk. There are now 500 Blockbuster Express machines, and plans call for 2,500 more by the end of the year. Here's what the real battle's over new releases and how much is charged. If you get a new release and you buy it, the average sales price is $25. If you get it on demand, which is either from Netflix or a Blockbuster over the internet, it's about $5. Actually, $4.99. Store rental is $5 to rent it. The rental kiosk is $1. It barely shows up. So the difference between 25 and 1 is huge. The Illinois company, which charges $1 a day for goods, is expected to have 22,000 machines in supermarkets, Walmart stores, and fast food outlets by December. This was written in in October and has been revised. They are now at 30,000 machines. They are in negotiations for the rental of video games. Let's talk about missed chances. Back in the olden days, I get senior citizens discounts everywhere now. Look at these studios. And they produce these big reels of film. And they send them to a lot of local theaters. That's represented there. The technology changed. And VHS eventually became the standard. Well, who took advantage of that? Was it the studios? Blockbuster. The internet spread. Broadband began to spread. So concerned about the industry, about that little CD right there, you realize that the photo motion picture industry gets money for every CD sold. We went to Congress to try to and got that concession. And Netflix emerged. Now what I want to ask you is, why is Blockbuster now trying to catch up with Netflix? They were in the business of renting movies, delivering movies. Why does a coin company at home red box? By a coin company, I'll tell you what I mean. Down at the Food Line where I just used to live, there's a machine, I think it may be in all of them, where you can go dump your pennies in there and whatever and get enough, get to a printout or card or something. I haven't done it many times because I haven't had that much money, but I've dumped it in and they produce those cards and they give you a card or ticket back and you've got what you can spend there in the store and the store wants it there so you can spend your money there. You know what stores are doing with red boxes? They're offering some promotions. Buy three packages of shampoo, you get a free code. Because you can't go online and rent for one of these boxes, and they'll send you a code back, and you just walk up and punch in. The question I want to ask you is, why does a coin company own Red Box? And why, at every stage, did the industry leader miss the opportunity? Precisely because they were the industry leader. They couldn't see beyond that. Now, for a long time, Lee County was one of the leaders in this state in bringing jobs. We're not.
See why he played football.
Now, I've said this before. I've said it again. There's some information that's on a blue sheet of paper you may remember from before. If you don't have one, they have it. I'm going to be sending you some places on the internet where you can look at some very brief videos. Suppose this is true. The end of the job as a way of organizing work, it is a social artifact that has outlived its usefulness. Its demise confronts everyone with unfamiliar risk and rich opportunities. And my concern is that I will do anything I can to support in a nonpartisan and non-political way the examination of our future Not just me here without community because I'm what's called an iconoclast. I do things that people say can't be done. Sometimes wrong, sometimes right. But I'm usually alone when I start. But as you go forward, we've got this challenge with employment in this community. And bringing up that school to standards will help us economically. I believe that. We need to be planning. We don't want to be the industry leader who missed the chances. We want to be the red box of providing economic opportunities for our folks. Not sure how much time I have, if you have any questions or whatever, but that's pretty much what I want to say.
Okay, are there any questions? Thank you very much. Your point's well made, and it's something that I think we're all in different ways kind of working through, and you know, stay tuned. We're all in it together, and we're seeing the beginning of change, I suppose, like we've never seen before in the job market. And in any event, thank you very much, and there are ways that we will express ourselves as we move forward, but this is very useful and helpful. Thank you. The next part on our agenda is a presentation by Mrs. Minter regarding a financial statement. Good evening.
Good evening. How are you?
Good.
Good evening. Tonight we're going to present to you the financial update for the fiscal year 2009. We're going to do things a little differently. In the past, we've had the auditors come up at the end of the presentation, and this year Paula Hodges, who's one of the CPAs with our auditing firm, Martin Stearns and Associates, is going to go ahead and come up and give you the auditor's comments at the beginning of the presentation, and then I'll take back over and actually give you the financial numbers and go through those with you at this time. So I'll turn over to Paula this time.
Good evening.
Good evening.
It's great to be back in Lee County to present your audit results. Our audit opinion, which is what you engaged us to do, it was unqualified. And what that means is there were no areas in which we as your auditors and the management of Lee County could not reach an agreement as it relates to your financial statements. It's also known as a clean opinion. So it's the best opinion that you could get. So it's all good news. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about our audit process. Our audit process, it's a year-long process. It begins in planning, and what we do in our planning stages is we assess your risk, and then we design our procedures to address that risk. And so what that means is that our procedures, they change each and every year, depending upon what we consider to be risk areas. And then, sometime before year end, we come on site and we conduct our interim procedures. And our interim procedures, what they are, we test your compliance with federal and state awards. And I'm pleased to inform you that we had no findings or question costs as it relates to your administration of federal and state awards. And we also test your internal control system. We don't issue an opinion on your internal control system, but if we have any kind of recommendations, we make those recommendations in a letter that's issued along with your financial statements. So that's really what we do during our interim process. And then after year end, we come outside again. And that's where we do our final procedures, and we test the numbers that you find in your financial statements. And once we're finished with our final procedures, then we leave your finance director with a final trial balance, and she continues to draft your financial statements. And I just want to recognize that your finance director does draft your financial statements, and that's not an easy task. These statements are very complex, and she does an excellent job at doing that for the county. So I just want to take a minute to commend her and recognize her for that. Once The report's drafted. It's due to the Local Government Commission by October 31st. Your report has been submitted and it has been approved by the Local Government Commission, so you have your final results. And then your process starts all over again. The audit process, it went very, very well this year, as it always does. And the reason that it went so well is because we find the employees of Lee County to be knowledgeable and helpful and always prepared. And we have no complaints with how the audit process went. And I just want to publicly thank them for their assistance during that process. And then the rest of your information, it's all your information, and it's going to be presented to you by your finance director, Ms. Lisa Minter. If you have any questions for me, please feel free to ask me once she finishes her presentation or now.
Thank you.
So thank you.
You and I did not pay her to make those comments. To tell you that. Tonight, what we want to I want to go through with you on is the general fund activity, our fund balance position, which I know is always of concern to everyone, our debt position, and our single audits and grants, and we'll have time for questions. To begin with, we'll talk about general fund revenues. For the 2009 fiscal year, our revenues and transfers from other funds totaled $61,419,859. This represents a decrease from the fiscal year 2008 of 0.06%. So we did drop a small amount from the previous fiscal year, where normally we would, in the past years, we have normally seen an increase. Our major revenue sources continue to be property taxes, which make up 58.7% of our general fund revenues, sales taxes at 14.6%, and our intergovernmental revenues at 14.8%. As far as general fund revenues go, this is a comparison of this current past year versus the 2007-2008 year. The 2007-08 year is the blue line. The more burgundy line is the fiscal year 2009. As you will see, we had a lot of places where our revenues were down, mainly in sales taxes. That was due to the economy, plus the loss of part of our Article 44 due to the Medicaid relief. We also saw a drop in other taxes. The majority of that is related to the deed stamp excise tax being down. We saw a drop in the registered deeds permit permitting fees, which correlates with the deed excise tax also being down. We saw a drop in sales and services, and a drop in our investment earnings, which is strictly tied and more to anything than it's tied strictly to the economy and the lower interest rates we're receiving on our money. Property taxes for the year, our revenues totaled $36,048,729, which was an increase of 3.5% over the fiscal year 2008. And part of that increase over the previous years was the increase in prior year collections, where we had hired the Zacchaeus firm to come in and work on collecting past due taxes. So that's where that can be. So the graph shows you kind of where our growth has been from year to year, and you can see that there was a very small growth from 2007-2008 to the 2008-2009 fiscal year. As far as the assessed value goes, our assessed value at the end of the year was $4,717,379,879, which was an increase of 2.5% over fiscal year 2008. This graph also then shows you where our different types of our assessed value have been. You can see that the green line there has been utilities, and that stays pretty steady from year to year, which is the goal, I believe, of the Department of Revenue with the way they assess the values for the utility companies. The red line going across there is the personal property values, and you can see that we are not seeing a lot of growth in our personal property values, means people are, some of the businesses are not retooling up and stuff over the last couple of years. The biggest growth, as you can see, continues to be in our real property. And that was not a large growth from the previous year. Additional information on property taxes. We did collect 98% of our levy for the fiscal year 2009. 99% was collected if you exclude motor vehicles, which is very, very good. considering the economy this past year. The tax department did an outstanding job working to get that much collected. Motor vehicles continue to be a problem area. We collect 87% of the motor vehicle taxes. We're anxiously looking forward to the switchover where it is done with the license plate and hope that that will pick up our collections. They are working on that. They have started the meetings with the various counties to try to get that system up and running. They have, in my opinion, a daunting task ahead of them. I think Dwayne will and Mary probably agree with you on that too, to get that in place, but we're looking forward to that so we can pick up those collections. Our collections did exceed budget for the fiscal year. Current year collections exceeded by $530,942. Prior year did exceed by $225,937. The flip side of having great collection rates is you have less prior year money to collect in future years, so there is a catch there, so it does play into that for future years. The top 10 taxpayers are displayed here for you. Wife continues to be the largest taxpayer in Lee County with 5.3% of the total value of Lee County. And if you look on page 105 of your financial statements, you will see a comparison of the top 10 now versus 9 years ago and see where some of these shifted. Overall, it's pretty much the same group, even from 10 years ago. There might be one or two new ones on the list from 10 years ago. Sales tax revenue, being our second largest revenue source, totaled $8,998,757, which was a $2.3 million decrease from the fiscal year 2008, or 20.3%. Part of that, as I've already mentioned, is due to the Medicaid relief in addition to the downturn in the economy. As you can see, the different colors there, the kind of purplish color is the Article 39, which is the 1% sales tax. You can see that that is down from the previous year and the lowest it's been in the last 5 years shown there. The burgundy section would be the Article 40 and then the yellow is 42. We saw some decline in those two areas, but not as significant on the per capita distributions. The kind of light blue-green there is the Article 44, and that we did see the significant drop because we lost part of that, half of that for the majority of the fiscal year due to the Medicaid relief. Move on into expenditures at this time. Our expenditures and transfers totaled $61,526,160 for the year, which was an increase of 2% over fiscal year 2008. Human services and education continue to account for the majority of the county's expenditures. Here, there's a graph that compares the expenditures between 2 years. The blue column would be 2007-2008, and fiscal year 2009 is shown in the red. You can see that in a lot of cases, even though our expenses were up, a lot of the sections were down. General government was slightly below fiscal year 2008, public safety the same way. Human services was a good bit below. That is due to Medicaid relief, and that's not having to pay out the full amount of Medicaid for the whole year. Biggest reason we were up, when you take all that into balance, was the increased contribution to education that was made due to the opening of the third middle school in Lee County and the debt related to the new high school and new middle school that we picked up. Cultural and recreational was down, and debt service was up just a little bit over the fiscal year 2008. Education expenditures account for, including debt service in those, account for 43.05% of the general fund's expenditures. As far as Lee County Board of Education, current expense for the year of 2009, we paid $15.6 million. Capital outlay, and this includes all funds, money from sales tax, lottery, public school building, etc. We spent $2.5 million, almost $2.6 million. For debt service related to Lee County Board of Education, we spent $5.4 million. For total expenditures related to Lee County Board of Education of $23.6 million. This was an increase of 20% over the fiscal year 2008 and accounts for 38.49% of your total expenditures. For CCCC, we spent $2.1 million, almost $2.2 million on current expense. We gave $55.7 million to the Civic Center from the general fund. That's not, this does not include money for the room occupancy tax fund. Excuse me, $55,000. Sorry. Thank you. Capital outlay was $8,000. Debt service was $541,700 for a total of almost $2.8 million. That represented a 5.9% increase over fiscal year 2008. And that represented 4.6 of the general fund expenditures. Bottom line, for 2009, our revenues and transfers in totaled $61.4 million. Our total expenditures and transfers going out were $61.5 million, meaning we had a decrease in our fund balance of $106,301. As far as the fund balance summary goes, this graph you've seen from year to year shows you the total fund balance we have, the fund balance available. The total fund balance is the dark burgundy column. The fund balance available is the lighter blue column. And you'll see due to that drop that I just showed you, the 106,000 decrease, that our total fund balance did come down. However, our fund balance available is up, and the fund balance available is based on your expenditures and other things. And so because our budget is coming down, since we made significant cuts last year, made significant cuts in our expenditures during the year and then further cut our budget, our fund balance available is up. You can see there the different lines. You've got the 8% floor that is recommended by the LGC. You've got your targeted floor of 14% and your targeted 18% is the pink line, and you can see that in all areas you do exceed those for the coming year. At the end of June 30th, 2008, your fund balance available percentage was 18.2. At the end of June 30th, 2009, is 19.3. And as I said, that is a function of your expenditures along with other things. Summary of fund balance. Your available fund balance totaled $11.8 million. Increase of $927,000 from fiscal year 2008. Of your, as I just said, it's 19.3% of your 2009 expenditures. Taking into account what we had budgeted for 2010, if we did not, that number did not change over this fiscal year, we would be at 19.9%. Statewide average as of 6/30/2008. Your slides may say 6/30/2007, but I went back and corrected that. The average for our population group was 24.8%. And that is partially due to, we have Dare County in with our population group.
Brunswick.
I knew it was one of the beach communities. I said the wrong way. They do keep a lot more fund balance because of the storms that they face. Most of the stuff is reimbursement. They have to pay up front, so they do keep a larger amount of reserves. So that does skew the numbers somewhat for our group.
Lisa, when a storm hit the web, have a way of determining what their fund balance drops to at that time?
I have not looked. I'd have to go back and do some research on that to see.
I'm just curious.
I'm sure they can when they've tracked some storms. Mm-hmm. You know, we've been blessed and not have much hit us in the last couple of years. Mm-hmm. As far as our debt position, total debt outstanding as of 6/30/2009 was $62,458,000. That is broken down into bonds, certificates of participation, and installment notes. And you can see the certificates of participation for the high school and the middle school and other school and community college projects we've done totaled $51,475,000. Installment note does include the QSAB that we did last year in August for that, for repairs and renovations at various schools. As far as our debt levels and our financial policies, outstanding debt as a percentage of the assessed value for fiscal year 2009 was 1.2. Our maximum as far as our financial policy is 2%. So we are still well in line with that policy. Debt service payments equaled 11.8% of our expenditures for 2009. The policy is 15%. That is a number that you may, that is a percentage that you may see next year be up because our expenditures are down. So the debt payments are not dropping as much as our budget did. So that number you will probably see go up next year. Okay. Single audit and grants, this relates to the compliance fees that Paula mentioned to you. Lee County totally managed $79.9 million in grant funds. DSS was responsible for $74 million of that. $5.9 million actually comes through our hands, for lack of a better way to put it. Direct vendor payments accounted for 68.1% of that. So that means 68% of the $68 million of the money never comes into our balances, but our employees determine the eligibility and make sure those funds go into the right hands. Okay. Health department handles another big chunk of that through various programs. Programs that were audited by the Martin Starnes included WIC, the subsidized child care program, Medicaid, and the food stamp program. That is the major programs as determined by the state's requirements for this year. I'd be glad to entertain any questions you may have at this time.
Questions?
Just have a comment. Good job. This was thank you. Very informative.
And I need to say thank you to my staff and to all the departmental staffs. We did have a very smooth audit. Everybody was cooperative and easy to work with, and I'm pleased to end up as good as we did this year. It is better than what we had anticipated, and the departments need to be commended for that. They took heed to directions from the manager and directives from the board and tightened up their belts very much so, and it paid off in the long run.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we will hear from Mr. Surface giving us an update on the health department. Mr. Surface.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners. Board of Health reviewed and approved four items at their November 10th meeting, and I'm bringing these to your attention tonight. Anytime the Board of Health receives money and grants in any way, we have to get approval from the Board of Commissioners, so that's why I'm appearing before you tonight. The first is in the immunization program. The state has offered each county, including Lee County, an amount of money, and in our case it's $7,000 to help purchase some equipment items. And we are taking a look at that at this point. We've not made any final decisions. We want to see where we stand with H1N1 and with the rest of our immunization programs. So the Board of Health's recommendation is to approve the increase in our budget of $7,000 for the immunization program. There is no local money match.
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
I was just going to ask if you needed a motion.
Yeah. Unless you wanted to do them, sir, all at any time, as the commissioners wish on that.
Well, we could do all four if there's a general sense here that that would be okay. All right. We'll do all four then. Do you want to just move ahead then and just speak to each one of those briefly, and then we'll just vote for all of them?
Yes, sir. The health department allocates to the family planning program through the Coalition for Families of Lee County a program called Sister Love. And what Sister Love does is they go out and they talk with local citizens, and we take a look at what's happening in terms of family planning. And Carolyn Spivey does an excellent job. It's basically identifying and mobilizing community partners to implement a community plan, and we take a look at reducing infant mortality and morbidity, and that's why it goes into family planning. Carolyn Spivey does an excellent job. Normally this would go into the budget for this year. It didn't because we weren't sure we were going to get it. So Carolyn hasn't received any of this money yet. So if you approve it, you can start cutting her some checks tomorrow. Or not tomorrow, Mr. Crump. H1N1 funds, we have been appreciative of what you have given us for H1N1 as well as the state and the feds. They've come through with an additional $18,000, $18,678. So we are adding that to our budget. Now, the reality of H1N1 is that we will probably return federal, local, and state dollars simply because we're not getting the number of persons in to get vaccinated. However, when the money is given out, we do accept it. That's added to the budget, and then we turn right around and use it as best we can, trying to maximize federal and state first. And then when it has to be returned, we do that through the county's process. And then the last item is an increase in WIC funds in the amount of $21,960. We want to do two things with this. We want to work with the library director, Mr. Matoshik, and the library board, as they have approved, as has the Board of Health, are establishing a satellite office in Broadway, in North Carolina. We hope to have that set up in February. This money will be used to hire an additional staff person to do that. And what we're going to initially do is utilize a graduate student out of Chapel Hill to begin to set up the program. And then when she leaves the program later in the spring, probably hire a full-time person or some permanent person. And then we want to work with Ag Extension in their expanded food and nutrition education program. That's second because the state wants us to primarily focus initially on, let's put WIC together well, let's do it in Broadway, and let's make that work. But as I told Susan Conlon this afternoon, we will be working with you later in the spring. You won't be forgotten in that process. We think WIC is a good program. We think Broadway is a logical place for that to go. And it is one of our economic machines in the county, and it brings in excess of about $2.4 million a year in terms of food voucher value. I'd be glad to answer any questions commissioners may have.
Any questions? There is a motion to approve all four of these sources of income. And so all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? There's no opposition.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next item is page 130 in our agenda books, and it has to do with relief of penalty for Windstream North Carolina LLC. And Mr. Brinson, would you speak to us about that?
Yes, sir. The public utility companies are required by the Department of Revenue to list any property by March 31st. It goes directly to the Department of Revenue, does not come to the county. Once these listings are turned into the Department of Revenue, the Department of Revenue assesses them, and then we get a tax roll of the values of all these companies, and we bill them accordingly. This year, Windstream failed to list by March 31st. They actually filed a listing May 31st, a couple months late. The Department of Revenue assessed them with a 10% penalty as required by law, and Windstream is now contesting that, and they will request relief of that penalty. The amount of the penalty is $30,976.11 for the county and the fire district. There is additional penalty for the city, and Windstream would need to go to the city for that relief. And I'm happy to entertain any questions. On page 142, I will point out, there is an email from Mr. Wilkes from the Department of Revenue, the man who assesses the public utility companies. And you can see a brief explanation there of giving you the same dates that I've already given you. And the last page, which is 143, gives you a more detailed breakdown of the actual penalty. I'm happy to entertain any questions that we're going to have.
Okay, if you'll stand by. Is Mr. Binkley here? Yes, sir. Or you wish to speak to us?
Yes, please.
On behalf of Windstream, please come forward. Give us your name, your address, and your position.
I'm actually John Phillips instead of Jeff Binkley. I work closely with Jeff with Thomson Reuters on behalf of Windstream. And wanted to talk to you a little bit about the issue tonight. Our office address is 229 Peachtree Street, Atlanta, Georgia, 30303. What happened in this particular case, Windstream, who has been a longtime filer and centrally assessed taxpayer in North Carolina, has always requested an extension to file from March 31st to May 31st with the DOR. Now, in this particular case, there was turnover within their tax department, and there was turnover with the firm that they had represented them from someone else to us. They filed for extensions in all their other states, and they actually have a lot of locally assessed property in North Carolina as well. They filed for those extensions. Somehow, the centrally assessed extension to Bill Wilkes in North Carolina DOR was neglected until the last week in May, when we contacted the DOR and asked him to confirm that he had the extension letter, which he said, no, I never saw it. So there was obviously a mistake made there. DOR felt that their hands were tied in levying the penalty under the discovered property section of the North Carolina General Statutes. They did file within the normal extended deadline of May 30th, which would be, in previous years, we'd be given May 30th, May 31st as the extended deadline. There was no delay in the assessment, and there was no actual discovery taking place here. The intent of this North Carolina statute is to cover the cost of additional resources expended during the discovery process. There was a case mentioned earlier where something was not filed locally, and it required the county assessors to go through the process of discovery, amending the listing, et cetera, et cetera. None of that happened in this case. Value was agreed upon in June of this year, which is actually earlier than it has been in years past. Last year it was late August. Allocation of the value was done in a timely manner from DOR to the county, all the counties. There's a number of counties involved in this particular issue. And they failed to file the extension, and there is a penalty per section 105, 312, which is what was levied in this case. There's also a separate penalty specific to public service corporations, which is under 105.343. Now, that particular penalty applies to late filing of PSC reports to the state, which is applicable in this case, of $100 a day for the late filing. I believe, given the intent of the statute that was applied here and the intent of 105.343, there's kind of a contradiction there. We feel that 105.343 is certainly more appropriate. And given the fact that there was no additional resources expended at the DOR level, the county level, or any individual jurisdiction level, we would ask that you, under your authority, under 105.312 paragraph K, compromise this penalty in this particular case.
Okay. Are there any questions?
So the $100 a day penalty would be what compared to the $30,000? This was 2 months,
60 days? 60 days, $30 a day. I mean, $100 a day. So what was that, $6,000? And that actually, since this is handled at the state level, goes into the DOR general fund, or the state's general fund via DOR.
I have a question. This is something that's occurred across part of the state where Windstream provides these services. In how many counties is this case?
The total number of counties, and I don't know exactly, but it's somewhere in the 15, 20 range. Do you know?
I think it's 16.
16 counties. Mm-hmm. 16 counties. Some of the counties, the value is so small that it's not really worth the effort to go through the process. Thus far, we have resolved the issue with three counties, and all three have completely compromised the penalty. Mm-hmm.
What three are those?
Rowan, Davidson, and I'm unsure of a third. Now, there are two that I presented to last week, Stanley and where's it? Statesville?
Iredell.
And they're both still under consideration by their Board of Equalizations.
Are part of the assets that are listed there landlines and whatever also, or is this real estate and then stuff like trucks and equipment? Is any of it actual?
It's mostly personal property. There's very little. In fact, I think that this whole listing was personal, wasn't it? It's there's lines, there's switching equipment. It's a plethora of equipment.
So. The actual penalty, I think, is $42,994.
That is correct, including the city of Sanford's penalty.
Okay.
The other jurisdictions.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We need a motion.
Move to accept the recommendation of the tax assessor.
Motion's been made to accept the tax assessor's recommendation, which is to deny relief of penalty from discovery for Windstream North Carolina LLC. Any discussion about that? If not, we'll proceed to vote. All in favor of denying relief of penalty, please indicate so by saying aye. Aye. Opposed? It's denied. We deny relief unanimously. Thank you very much. Is that clear, Dwayne?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. The next item is the resolution. Sorry, I got lost in my notes here. A resolution levying an additional 0.25%, 0.25 tax, and it's before us on page 144. And Mr. Reeves has made the motion that this be approved, I believe. Is that correct, sir?
As recommended.
As recommended. Is there any discussion?
Like to make some comments just to set the record straight on a couple of misstatements about why I'm opposing this. One of the reasons I heard was that I just am against public education. That couldn't be further from the truth. I have been a public school teacher. I've been very involved in education. So that certainly wasn't the reason. Another reason was I was opposed because I'd signed a no tax pledge. And while I am a member of Americans for Prosperity, Freedom Works, Citizens Against Government Waste, and the National Taxpayers Union, which are all taxpayer advocacy groups, my main concern with this is the timing of $20 million of debt with the economic conditions on the ground they are. Now, since the election took place, there's some data that's come out from the state that I want to share with us because I think it's relevant to this, but I think it's also relevant to our budget when we're doing our budget next year. And this first is some data from the Fiscal Research Division of the North Carolina General Assembly. And so basically, collections by the state through October are $95 million below. I thought it was interesting that that reflects the increase in the sales tax and tobacco and alcoholic beverage tax increases, which they passed. Main weakness continues to be the sales tax, which is tracking about 2% below expectations. Withholding also is obviously down because of the employment situation. An interesting graph, but the text with it said that sales tax collections continued to plummet in the first quarter of this year, declines more than double what they were last recession. And an interesting comment says there's added pressure on sales tax collections from the 1 cent increase that took effect in September. With continued weakness in collections, there could be cause for concern. And some other important things there. So that concerns me. Another article that came out was a WRAL where Medicaid spending just in the first quarter of this year is $150 million over budget at the state level. News and Observer came out with an article that said the state has incurred $1.4 billion in debt just to pay the unemployment, and sometimes they're borrowing as much as $20 million a day on that. And John sent us out a memo, and although I think this will have the smallest impact on our budget, was the rate of increase for the local government and employer retirement system. You know, that's going to go up. And I think that, you know, all of those support the position that I took. And while I certainly respect the positions everybody else took, I hope that you all can respect the position that I took. I just want to make one other comment on the, I think it was reported in the paper and others that this was a unanimous mandate. And election data that I saw, we have a little over 32,000 registered voters in Lee County. There were 3,832 who voted for this. And so I just don't see that as an overwhelming majority. There are actually only I think total county-only ballots were 2,807. So I just, you know, I see no reason why this isn't going to go forward. Elections do have results, and I'm sorry that there wasn't a larger turnout, but I hope everybody understands the position that I took on this.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Shook. We're going to vote now, and there's one last opportunity for you to move over to the other side if you wish.
Why, thank you.
And make it unanimous.
That's better offers today, though.
Okay. All in favor, well, we have Mr. Reeves has made the motion, and all in favor of the motion to approve resolution to levy additional one quarter penny county sales and use taxes presented, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay. Six yeas, one nay, and the motion carries. Thank you very much. The next item, I'm sorry. Yes. Okay. Very good. And for the record, the collections began April 1st of 2010. Okay. Very good. Thank you. Item G on page 149 of our agenda book has to do with the appointments to the rest home, nursing home advisory board. We have two vacancies. Oh, again, I'm sorry. Mrs. Lee, would you please speak to us? I was looking down.
Okay, Mr. Chairman and fellow commissioners, you will see on page 149 of your agenda where we have two vacancies on the rest home and nursing home advisory board. One of these is due to a resignation, and the other is an individual that has not attended any meetings during 2009, so the advisory board is asking that individual be replaced. There are two applications that have been submitted. I've spoken with both ladies, and both of them are willing to serve. So I'm asking for you to consider those two applications or submit other names for consideration.
Move to accept.
The motion's been made to accept these two individuals as replacements for the two that are leaving. Any discussion or questions? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? There is no opposition. Thank you very much. The next item is a discussion item about the economic development meeting that we had back on November the 19th. All four boards met, sort of a historical kind of thing in and of itself, but the idea was to bring forward a fresh new discussion about the activities of our economic development corporation, what they have done, are doing, and how they envision the future. And the invitation was to members of the boards to raise questions that they had always been wanting to ask, perhaps, and to, on a very positive note, ask ourselves the question, are there things that we can say and do and set in motion that will help our local business and industry, and especially get our unemployment back on track too. And so I wanted to sort of make that little statement and then ask if there are any comments that any of you commissioners have relative to what you saw and heard on November the 19th, and with any suggestions that you might have as well.
Mr. Chairman, I had a suggestion. One, I thought it was a great meeting and very informative. But the thing that I came away with was perhaps forming a committee with representatives from the two municipalities and from our board to look at the EDC strategies and goals that we have in the county kind of with fresh eyes. Things have changed a whole lot, and we need to do better about bringing jobs into the county.
And,
I'm sure there's other more well-qualified folks on the board, but if you want me to, that's fine. But I think there's a lot of new and innovative things that we can do that a lot of other counties and municipalities are trying, and we don't need to just have the meeting and let things die. We need to rev up and let's get going.
Thank you.
Let me ask you this. What is it that you learned in that meeting? Any of you? Because there are four people on this board that certainly ought, one does, three others ought to know what economic development does. Now, I can understand you three to some extent, but nothing has prevented you from going to those meetings since you've been elected and even before you were elected. So tell me, if you will, what it is you picked up in the meeting, because I don't recall there being enough time to even ask questions.
Well, that was one of my problems. I agree with you. It kind of was just sort of a presentation, and then there wasn't much question and answer. But one of the things, and the big thing that I learned, was that, yes, we need to come together, the stakeholders, and revisit the issue and try to look at doing things differently that'll bring jobs to the county as soon as possible.
Then are you now suggesting that there be another layer added to the process with this committee?
Perhaps.
Okay.
Maybe something that would address more small businesses.
We're paying BRAC to participate in theirs. We're paying this board. You're now creating another layer. We work with, supposedly working with Department of Commerce, Economic Development. The only people getting jobs are us.
Well, I mean, point well taken. But okay. but I think that the thing that I came away with, though, was maybe we've gotten a little stagnant. Maybe just the playing field has changed. But we need to look at things. Our policies, you know, I mean, it's our policy. It's not the EDC policy.
Well,
and we need to rethink some of the ways we do things, not necessarily form another level, but maybe add some more opportunities to bring jobs into the county.
Let me say that, and I laughed when I attended that meeting. I attend because I'm a member of this board. I'm not a person who enjoys meeting for the sake of not having anything to do with me. But let me say this to you. I show up at the joint school board meeting in the rain, late, and I come in and walk into a $19.5 million increase. I come into this meeting on time, and I look across, and I see a friend of mine said to the Economic Development Board, y'all need to be coming back and asking them for more money. You need to be lobbying us. Have we turned into, what is this about? Spending money, we're getting way out of line in terms of throwing money, good money, after common sense processes. You know, you're talking about how do you go about improving your economic opportunities. And I don't want to leave the city out. I heard one council person say, let's hire two more people, as if we don't have enough. Now, folks, if that's what we're going to be about, we don't need to recruit. Just keep spending county money. And
hey,
we'll all go broke the
right.
Same way.
But
let me finish. Okay. Let me finish. Because one of the things that I came out to hear, not how it works. I know how it works. You can read that. It was in the Governing Magazine. The whole process is in there. How it works. But we spent 2 hours listening to two people tell us about how it works. Here's what I did not hear. If this was your business, not you, Amy, this board, if it was your business, you would be looking at how to take care of the rest of what you have, how to save what we have. You know what? I kept listening. I said, well, maybe I'm going to hear them say that one of the things we're doing on the Economic Development Board is that we're contacting the remaining folks in this county to find out where they are, where they're doing, and what we can do to help. And let's include small business, because They're the lifeline.
That's right.
It was embarrassing to me to sit there funding a group that has a person who is totally autonomous, independent. He doesn't even report to your county manager. He has to make arrangement to get, for the county manager has to wait until he's in a position to do what he's got to do. And that's the way we set this thing up.
But I mean that's what I'm getting at, Robert, is that, you know, I'm not talking about another level and more money. I would like to see less money and more results. But we're not gonna get that unless the stakeholders, the two municipalities and us, you know, we get together and say, this is the way we want to do business and this is what we expect from that board. You know, I know I'm still sort of new at this, but I think we need to communicate that, and we need to spring forward from that meeting and come up with another plan.
What am I hearing here? We're talking about another board to make recommendations to this board?
No.
I think that's what.
Let me try to answer some of this as I understand it, but I think that we talked about the possibility of, after this meeting, to get a few people from each of the four boards together, maybe two people from each board, eight individuals, could be more, could be less, to try and develop a set of activities that the Economic Development Corporation could carry forward, could put into action some new things, some new approaches that, if they were agreeable, might be helpful for us to get at small business, at enterprise in Lee County. In other words, it's been my observation. I've looked at some of the counties that are doing things around us, and you know, we can hold our own pretty much, but we don't have a patent on things. And there are some ideas that had been coming out since we got into this 3 or 4 months ago talking about it. And I just wanted to sort of address two or three of these very, very briefly. But one is something like an enterprise campus that the community college is very interested in considering. And this would bring together private and public funds to look at how to be an incubator and to help start new businesses in Lee County. And they're very interested in this, but I think they're interested only as one of four boards that would wish to see something like this really take off. There would be questions and there'd be resources and things that might be necessary if we felt, the committee felt, and these boards approved something like that taking hold and going forward. Another thing was a small business revolving loan fund that might be something worth considering, whereby the four boards would go together and the funding boards would put money into a revolving fund. This is being done in other places, and for those candidates who are not eligible for incentive grants, and that we would help these small businesses really get underway, and it would be a revolving kind of fund. There are ways that this can be done, and I don't believe we're doing this at the present time in Lee County, but I know that it's happening around us, and it seems like this would be a very good idea. And so there are these kinds of, and a strategic plan. I'm not sure that we have required that of the Economic Development Corporation. That is anew, telling them, this is what we want you, this is what we would have you consider over the next 3 years. Specifically, what are your target goals, and what do you expect to be the outcomes? Do you need resources from us? I think the question is a valid question. We may or may not have the resources, but what do you need from these boards to do a better job than you're doing right now. I think that's a very valid consideration. And I think that's the kind of thing that some of us were hoping would start to bubble up some new ideas. And I think, as Mrs. Dalrymple says, you know, we've been sort of the same strokes with the same folks, and that's been fine in the good days when we were riding the bubble. And now that we're at the bottom of that, we're going to have to be creative, as Mr. Clark would suggest as well, creative in our thinking and how we're going to go about creating new jobs, and how we're going to be thinking outside of the box a little bit. And that's what this was about, an opportunity for us, for the first time, for me, to come together with you folks and to begin to say, is there more to be done? Can we do it better? It's not a slam at anybody. It's like an opportunity to raise some very good questions, see if we can come up with some good answers, and win in the process. Win by putting more people back to work, win by creating and giving incentives for new businesses to start in Lee County. I think there are real possibilities out there if we have the creative thinking and the energy and the courage to sort of move forward with this, and for heaven's sakes, Mr. Reeves, not to layer and to build more bureaucracy. That's something that I think no one would wish to do, because very obviously, because we don't want to put our money there. We want to put our incentives and our support behind getting so many people back to work who are out of work, and helping new businesses really have a fighting chance to start and to take hold and to help Lee County prosper. And so, you know, that's what this is all about. And I'm willing, and I know you are, and each one of you probably, to do everything we can to be a part of a sort of forward-leaning process that says we're not going to stand back and be reactors. We're going to be people who take charge and look for new and better ways to help our county prosper economically in the future. And the sooner the better, but it'll take a while. So,
can I add a comment here?
Please do.
I agree with Commissioner Reeves. Our very first step here is to talk with the job creators in this county. You know, it might be finding out what their challenges are with the new state and federal regulations that's keeping them from growing their businesses or maintaining the employees they have. That's the very first step. None of us here are in a position to choose winners and losers. And until we talk with the job creators, you know, we don't need to go any further, in my opinion.
Well, I think that's good. Mr. Reeves?
You know, do you have any idea how we got where we are today with industry in Lee County over the last 20 years? How do you think we got where we are?
A lot of hard work.
Yeah, but guess where it came from? Primarily from the Chamber of Commerce. Primarily from the Chamber of Commerce. When they were a one office operation and two people or three people and the community, is how Lee County, Sanford got where it is. And we've gotten away from that. You know why? Because we look over in Wake and Orange and other counties and say, oh, they got a board. We need to get us a board. And we started doing the same things. We don't have the same bases, but we start doing the same things. I'm not against any one person or any group of people. I am concerned that what we're doing is not paying attention to what goes on in other places. If we had a system in place that would allow this person who represents our board to control some of the activities that we ought to be looking into, we may be getting more bang for our buck. If you've got a situation where an individual does not have to be responsive to your request, you got a bad situation because you're not in control. And if you've got two other groups, two other elected bodies who also have their own agendas, you've got another situation that you've got to overcome. And so the additional committee that you may be considering is only going to impede where it is we need to be going right now, because somebody there will have their own best interests at heart. And the chamber is the one area that I suspect all businesses, legitimate businesses coming in this town, are going to be involved with sooner or later. And instead of us not paying attention and maybe bringing them to the table, and I know I haven't talked with them. I don't know if they have an interest, but I do know they ought to be invited to participate to see where they might fit into the whole scheme of things. But in addition to that, there are situations, those loans you're talking about, that are already in existence at the state level. But we don't necessarily, I haven't seen any reports that we've even made an effort to go after any of those. So let's, you know, I get frustrated in here because, no, I do, because, no, let me tell you why. Because too many people take things so personal. This is about folks and their livelihoods. And if you can't take it, you ought not to be here. But this is more about let's get something done other than meeting. And let's get our money invested in the right places and try and draw from that. Not just keep throwing more money after the same product.
What's your ideas, Robert? I mean, you know,
trying to get six people to this board here to understand that we all need to be working together and putting on your thinking cap and insisting that when we hold these kind of meetings, economic development ought to be here. But they're on the agenda, they ought to be here.
Once a month or
every time we meet, if they're on here, every time we meet. Every month we ought to know what's going on. And you know what, I've had, and this is not the first time, and unfortunately not since this man's been here, I've had to ask for notice before I read it in somebody else's paper what's going on in Lee County. The same folks that we're funding. Now, I made myself a promise. If we're going to have these discussions, make them legitimate. Stop playing around and pretending to be everybody's friend. This doesn't work that way. This is about the livelihoods of all the taxpayers in this county, one way or another. Whether you're working, seeking work, or you own the business, we're all in it together. So if you're going to be about change, then be serious about the change. If you're going to put the same thing you have in place now, we're not doing anything there. We're not doing anything. Another layer of bureaucracy is the one thing we don't need.
So just have the EDC folks come here at the next meeting and us have a discussion with them on...
I've got a question there. Aren't their meetings open to us?
Absolutely. Oh, sure, yes.
They're public meetings.
Well, I've asked a question, how many of us have been to that meeting?
I've been to a couple, but yeah. Not recently, no.
I think I may have been to one, maybe. I don't know. You know, that's a possibility.
But I mean, can...
Well, we can learn.
Let me tell you what I'm hearing.
Yes.
I'm hearing Mr. Reeves saying that we need to take control.
Thank you.
And that's pretty simple.
So that's they're coming.
I get criticized. He can say it. He knows exactly what I'm talking about.
What he says, if we wait on the other boards and wait for a kumbaya session, you know, we're missing the boat. And maybe it's time we set a course as a board, because all the citizens in Sanford and Broadway are our citizens, just like they are all these towns. And maybe we need to take a look at things as a board and what we want to do and how we're going to do things going forward. And with that said, you know, we're the biggest contributor.
I would ask this question. If we asked them to come to our meetings, how would the city of Sanford and Broadway's also involved here? How would we handle that? Have them?
The same way that we have to do it when we get on other boards.
Just have one of their reps.
They figure out what they're going to do and they go to the meeting. That's all. But, you know, and I'm very serious. When there was a situation and we had an economic development person on staff years ago, that allowed the board to have the final say-so. You don't have that anymore. You don't have that.
I understand where you're coming from, but I also see the flip side of the coin in that if we have Sanford going off in one direction, Broadway going off in one direction, and us going off in another direction, one hand's not, I mean, we're all disjointed and not trying to go for the same, I mean, if there's a company coming and all three are lobbying, you know, it could be.
Let me help you with that. We're not in the water and sewer business.
I'm talking about economic development.
I'm trying to tell you that they're always going to be at the table.
There's times now that we don't know what's going on, and I can't imagine if we were all disjointed.
I can't fault them.
If we have our own department and they have their own department, and then Broadway won't even have a department.
They have
funds to do it.
Well, there are basically three ways to do economic development. One was the way, actually, we've done all three here now.
Yeah.
Run it through the chamber, run it through the county, and run it through, you know, an EDC. Those are the three ways that it's done across the state.
I agree 100% with you that we need more control and we need to do things better.
Okay.
But I also see the flip side in that if EDC is autonomous and is run like a business, then they need to have a marketing budget. They need to have the tools necessary to actually go do what they're chartered to do. And then they need to have a strategic plan. I mean, all these things that I would do in my business. That's what I'm looking at that side. I agree with you on some of your aspects of control, because we have no control right now.
And to do what you're saying is simply growing an existing board that is not responsive to this board. You're making them larger.
No, I'm not.
If you increase the budget, what I want to say to you is this. Here's a good example of where I'm coming from. You know, you're saying we're going to be disjointed. I can't think of a time that we've done any recruitment in this county that the city didn't get a place at the table. They're always going to have a place at the table. Water and sewer is always going to be a necessity, and they're going to always be at the table because they run the water and the sewer.
If we throw our hands up and say, all right, let's stop this right now, and I'm saying from the city standpoint,
okay.
And they go, you know, really, why should we be in the business anyway? I mean, all of our citizens are Lee County. All of our citizens are Lee County residents anyway. Why should we pay anything?
Let me thank you all for this input. Let me just say this: we do need to move on. Mr. Reese, thank you for what you've said. Mr. Kelly, valid comments. Ms. Shook, Ms. Dalrymple.
Is this the same as rest in peace?
No. Final words for tonight. I think that we succeed by talking like this to each other and getting kind of excited and making strong points occasionally, because, you know, it's one thing to take control. It's another thing to have some ideas and to put them forward and a plan of action. But I think this is rich. This is good conversation, and let me just thank you, because I didn't mean for it to take so much time, but economic development is a very serious matter for us to be talking and debating and fussing about, absolutely. And we're seven people, and we have seven different heads and set of ideas about this, and we're trying to get it coordinated, and I think we're trying to move forward. And I hope we'll visit this again and come back to it. Yes?
One quick thing, because I think what Linda and Robert said was a great jumping off point. Can we request from the EDC that they talk to the existing businesses in the county and find out what they need.
I would like for us to do it, and I'll tell you why. I attended a roundtable, actually sponsored by the National Association of Manufacturers out of Moen, maybe 6 months ago. Really good information, and Senator Burr was there, and they were basically talking about the issues that affected them, like the cap and trade, the Employee Free Choice Act, and some of this. And I happened to talk to the lady at Moen, there were a lot of people there, and I said, you know, this is something I'd like to see our County Board of Commissioners maybe on a quarterly basis, is, you know, just have a round table with our current employers.
Robert.
For those who wish to participate, Robert.
Well, we're about due for a workshop, you know, or a retreat, whatever you want to call it. And maybe we should just can everything else that we normally do at a retreat and just do it on economic development.
I think that's a good idea. Yeah.
We can spin our wheels on what each of us think economic development is, but until we hear it from the mouths of the job creators.
And invite those folks to come to the retreat.
Absolutely.
And that's us taking the lead.
And we are. And we will.
Let's get people back to work.
Thank you very much. Next item on the agenda. Mrs. Minter's giving us the hard eye back there. She's next up again with the October financial report.
I always get to be a bad guy, don't I?
You get to be the good person today.
Okay.
So far, so good.
I'm going to pass out a correct. I noticed when I flipped my agenda over today, the back page was not correct. You got the wrong sales tax report. I apologize. You got the printout from DOR instead of the analysis that I usually give you, and I do apologize for that. But in your agenda package, you do have the monthly financial report. As you all know, sales tax runs 3 months behind, so the collections from your new sales tax will not come in until July 10th. As far as we run behind, but so keep that in mind when you look at this. We only have 2 full months of sales tax collections in so far. But as far as tax collections go, through October 2009, we are 9.62% of where we were ahead of the same period last year. I have discussed this with the tax department, and part of it's coming from a slightly higher tax base than what we had budgeted at, but a lot of it's coming from the mortgage companies and others paying their tax bills earlier this year. I don't know if they were just holding cash, the mortgage companies were just holding cash last year because of the sudden downturn in the economy for them, and this year things have stabled out, and I guess been with the bailout, and so they're going ahead paying, or our increased collection efforts last year have got people moving faster. But, you know, we think some of it's coming more from that than an increased tax base. We may see that level back out after January. Other taxes and licenses are running behind last year. This again would be recognized by the deed excise tax, which you saw was down for 2009. So I am concerned if we're still running behind even where we were last year, that we may still not be seeing a recovery there yet. When we're reviewing expenditures, I'm looking at 33.3%. Some of our departments are still running over that because of dues that are paid at the beginning of the year or maintenance agreements. IT is exceeding due to some completion of some major projects along with maintenance contracts. Economic development, as usual, is exceeding due to having paid out some invoices earlier this year. So that's the financial report. As far as sales tax goes, you can see the numbers there. While the sheet I just passed out to you shows that we're continuing to see a decline, that is the case. However, if you look at the other sales tax distribution, you will see that we had accounted for some decline, ongoing decline in our budget. And for the 2 months we have received, we are at roughly at 16% across the board as far as collections go. So we are in line at this time with where we were budgeting at. So yes, overall, collections are still coming in under where they were even this time last year, but that was budgeted for, and we at this point in time are where we thought we would be, or should be. Okay.
Thank you very much. Any questions of Mrs. Minter?
No questions of Ms. Minter, but I would like to make a couple of comments.
Mr. Crampton.
I didn't get to say anything in the audit report, but thank Ms. Minter and her staff for everything that they do in the audit. It's a tremendous amount of time. And they did a great job, and I appreciate their work on that. Also want to thank the department heads. Last year and this month, we were still looking at about a $2 million deficit in last year's budget, and we shrunk it down to $100,000 by the end of the year. It was a lot of work on the department heads level. And as you can see, with this year's, what we did last year to get ourselves shrinking and get smaller, I have a lot of my manager brethren who are very nervous about their budgets this year and where they're going to fall, and I'm one of the few that's not. And it's because we did the right things in this year's budget. Yes, sales tax were down, but we took an extremely conservative approach and dropped that sales tax number considerably. We dropped our fund balance appropriation considerably, where others were raising their fund balance appropriation. So, you know, I feel good about where we are. I know the things at the state level look bad, and that's probably my biggest worry is what's mm-hmm. going to happen with them next year, because I think we're where we need to be. Hopefully the state can get their act together and get there. Thank you to Ms. Minter, because my next comments have had nothing to do with financials. But for the board's knowledge, the Committee of 100 meets on Thursday. Charles Hayes will be there to give the economic state of Lee County or the state of the region report. It's a good show from Charles. He always has a lot of good things to say, and I would encourage board members to attend. The last thing is in March is the NACO Legislative Goals Conference in Washington, D.C. None of the commissioners have said they wanted to attend. So if the commissioners don't attend, I don't attend. So you know, if we're not going to send anybody up in attendance, we've just talked about several federal issues. It's a good time to go up and meet with our representative and our senators and talk to them about these things that are affecting us locally. When you make the time to go up there and see them, they give you their time.
What's the deadline on that, John?
I have to look at Ms. Lee.
Registration just started this week.
So, what's the?
I'm going to try to get.
What's the date again?
I think it's March 6th to the 8th. Mm-hmm.
And what if you see things that you feel like you need to have recommendations?
I will go if I'm the only one that, you know, the board wants to send.
I think that should always be an option.
Well, I'll be glad to go.
Yeah.
But I have it on my calendar to go already, so because I felt with what was going on this year that we would need to go.
Well, you make a good point about seeing our representatives there if we have an agenda and something to say to them, and you know, we're focused.
The association does a good job of getting us together with them too, you know, through events that they do outside of the conference. So it's a good trip. And Mr. Hull has been many times, and there's a lot of information there and a lot accomplished. So,
are you driving, Mr. Crumpton?
I don't know. Someone said you were taking the train. I got on Amtrak, and I tell you what, taking the train might be the deal.
Right.
So, okay. You know, but I will not be flying.
Right.
you can
assure
walk
you of that.
And you can fly now.
Then anything else, Mr. Crump?
No, sir, that's it.
Thank you very much for what you do.
Well, thank you.
We appreciate it. It's a good, you're helping us very much, and we appreciate what you try to do on a day-to-day basis. We thank you. Now we have commissioner's comment, and I'd like to start at the left. And Mr. Pascal? No comments? Mrs. Shook?
Couple things. I just want to say hats off to all of our Lee County employees. I serve on a couple of boards, the Fire Advisory Board and Social Services Board with people. I've also talked to others, and I think this economy has put a lot of people in a stressful mode, and it seems like our employees are getting more and more angry calls or visits from people, and I'm just really impressed at the professional way that they handle it. So I want to say thanks. And Susan, I've eaten almost all this. Thanks. Another comment I had was, I think I noticed, Richard, in your invocation last night or tonight that you, it was a little bit different. And so I hope at some point soon we'll address as a board what's going on with Forsyth County and whatever. And, you know, I hope this board has a backbone to do the right thing there. And, in fact, my dollar bill and my quarter still says in God we trust, so I'm not going to let the American Civil Liberties Union tell me that it doesn't. And I think, you know, maybe over the holidays for us to give a little thought, each of us, on the goals for next year for this board, some things that are important to each of us that we want to pursue and move from there. And that's about all I have.
Ms. Dalrymple?
Well, most of you probably know today is the 68th anniversary of Pearl Harbor, and with a lot of relatives that fought in World War II, and we're blessed in my family to have a lot of them still around. I just want to say thank you to that generation, because I don't think that we would have the country we have today and the liberties and the freedom that we have today without their sacrifice, and I just hope that we can hold their standard that they set for us, and just thanks and God bless, and everybody have a Merry Christmas.
Mr. Owen?
Well, I don't sound like an echo, but I want to thank our manager and the staff for the job they've done for the county this year. I think they've done an excellent job. People in the county are great.
Mr. Kelly?
I agree. I think anything coming out of this year, that if the taxpayers know that our county government is a whole lot better than it was last year, and a whole lot smaller, and a whole lot more efficient. And, you know, we might get up here and moan and groan at each other, but I tell you, we've made some big decisions, and this county's a lot better off right now than it ever has been in regards to its finances. Lastly, I just want to tell everybody Merry Christmas.
Mr. Reeves.
Merry Christmas and keep hope alive.
Thank you very much. Is there a motion?
Yes, I make motion that we go into closed session to discuss a personnel matter per North Carolina General Statute 143.318.11A6 and to consult with the county attorney to protect the attorney-client privilege per North Carolina General Statute 143-318-11A3.
Thank you very much. The motion's been made. All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye opposed. Thank you very much. We're now going into closed session.